observed then that there is a way to directly calculate the Grothendieck topology corresponding to a quotient in the theory of Indian type. The Grothendieck topology defined on the opposite of the category of the presented model, so this theory. And of course, this method for calculating the classifying topos is actually very direct, so it can be used for calculating many classifying toposes. For instance, I will just mention a couple of simple examples that, of course, are very well known. The Zariski topos of the ring, just the Zariski topos if we take the ring equal to Z, or the classifying topos for integral domains, just to give an example of an illustration of how the axioms transform into covering seeds. So in the case of the Zariski topos, the relevant theory is the theory of local rings. And even though the notion of local ring is apparently a second order notion, there exists a first order formalization of it, which is the following. So if x plus y is invertible, then either x is invertible or y is invertible. And of course, you also require non-triviality. So you see it is a
plus the axiom for a ring.
Yeah. So, yes, the language is the language of commutative links with unit. And what are the covering seeds? So in this case, we can take as a theory of pre-shift type the theory of commutative links with unit. So the finitely presentable models of these are just the finitely generated rings, which is the same thing as the finitely presented rings, in this particular case, not in general. And so how do the co-covering sieves, because here we are taking sieves on the opposite of the category of finitely presentable models, where basically we have these localizations. the sieves that cover are those which contain these families of localizations such that the ideal generated by these elements is one in the ring. So you can recognize, you see, how the, well, of course, one needs to carry out a bit of calculation to calculate the topology starting from the axiom, but you recognize where they come from. So for integral domains, what you have is, well, the axioms are, again, this, the non-triviality axiom, and then we have the product equal to zero. And how the co-covering sieves are made? Well, they are all of the form notice that we consider this families, you see, here apparently you start with just two things, but in order to have the transitivity property of Grothendieck topologies, we have to repeat these things a finite number of times. And this is why we end up with these things here. So here the condition is that the product of all these elements is zero. So you see very well in this situation that you see this corresponds to this condition, and taking the quotients, you see each formula gives rise to a model presented by, and then by pulling back these basic sieves along arbitrary arrows, because of course when you consider a Grothendieck topology generated, what you have to do is to take all the possible pullbacks and all the possible multi-compositions. So you can see that you end up with this thing. So I just wanted to give this simple and classical examples. And of course, it would be interesting to take more toposes relevant for algebraic geometry and try to describe specific theories that are classified by them. This has been made to a very, very little extent, because even though the theory of classifying toposes was born, as I said yesterday, in the 70s, the subject has remained quite dormant, unexpectedly, because, it was clear from the beginning that it was a very promising subject, and Grothendieck himself was very convinced about it. But then research took different direction, and so this theory stood essentially undeveloped. It is partly due to the fact that some people from the old generation of category theory, they sort of promoted a site-free ideology. I mean, they thought that sites were not really good objects to consider because of the fact that they are not canonical, they are not intrinsic. So they tried to replace toposes with concepts that could not, didn't need to sites to be studied or investigated. And the problem with that is that, of course, you really need sites in order to connect with the mathematical practice, because without sites you can do axiomatic considerations, which might be very interesting as well, but you don't realize the kind of unification of which Grothendieck was talking. I mean, Grothendieck, when he refers to unification, he really refers to the fact that one can build the toposes really from the ground. I mean, from objects such as sites or theories or groupoids or quantiles or whatever. I mean, from the fact that you can really build the toposes from the ground, and then this allows you to discover links between different theories by comparing the toposes that you can attach to them. So anyway, so I think that now classifying toposes have happily come back to life, so we don't have to worry anymore. But this is just to explain why even for very, very classical questions or even for very classical results, there is not much literature available. Okay, so now I would like to explain in general in what consists this bridge technique, which is what allows actually to perform this unification. So how does a bridge work in the abstract? We have already encountered, I think, 4 or 5 examples of bridges so far, but it's worth to systematize this in a more abstract way to know how to orient oneself in a variety of situations. Okay, so the bridge building technique. So as I have already said, the basic idea is you have different theories which are classified by toposes which might be equivalent, or sometimes you might also be interested to compare a theory whose classifying toposes are not equivalent, but between which there is a strong kind of relation, or, I mean, but for simplicity, I will just treat the case in which you have an equivalence, because in this way, you have more invariants at your disposal to perform translations. Because essentially, by an obvious meta-theorem, whatever you can formulate in categorical language will be automatically equivalent. And so this gives you a great amount of possible invariants to consider. And of course, for each such invariant, you will be able to try to make a translation and see what this invariant tells you in the context of one theory, and then what it tells you in the context of another. And now, this is, in some sense, the logical outlook on that. But since toposes are built out of sites most of the time, this has a technical translation in the situation where you have different sites of definition for the same topos. So most of the time you work actually with sites, so it's worth to consider situations like this. And so how do you do? Well, basically you consider an invariant I. So by invariant, I mean any kind of property or construction or notion that applies to toposes, and that you can transfer across this equivalence. So a property that you can decide to look indifferently from the point of view of the first representation or from the point of view of the second. Okay, so this is sort of the deck of the bridge. And then how do you build the arches of the bridge? Well, what you do is to try to find properties in the context of the two different sites. So here I write a property P, Cj. Here I write a property Q, Bk. And I want, essentially, these properties to represent sort of unravelings of this element in terms of the specific sites of the tension. So what I want, essentially, is imagine that I is a property. Ideally, I want equivalences of this kind. The site satisfies this property if and only if the corresponding topos satisfies the invariant. And of course, I want the same thing for the other site. Because this will give me the first arch, and the other one will give me the second arch. So imagine we have such a situation, we can conclude that these two properties are equivalent. And this can be interesting because even though at this level you have just one property, when you look at the way this property manifests in the context of different sites, you can have huge surprises. In the sense that you can find that in the context of these sites, this expresses in a certain way, and you can find that in the context of a completely different site, this expresses in a way that you would have never imagined without the aid of toposes to be related to the original property. To convince you about this, I will briefly mention a few simple invariants that one might want to consider. So as invariants are, you can take, for instance, the property of the topos to be atomic, Boolean, De Morgan, equivalent to a pre-shift topos. Compact, locally connected, valued, and so on. So you see, people who practice algebraic geometry, of course, are used to particular invariants called the cohomological invariants that, of course, are very important and that you can attach to toposes. And cohomology was actually the main motivation that led Grothendieck to the development of the concept of topos. But it turns out that these are by no means the only invariants that it is meaningful to consider on a topos. There are many, many invariants. Here I have just put some of them, but in fact there are infinitely many such invariants, and you can even fabricate your own ones in a very simple way. Basically, whatever thing crosses your mind, you write it down, and automatically, it might seem a weird thing to do, but in fact, one has really to change the way one usually thinks, in the sense that even a very weird invariant might give, when translated into context of different sites, might give surprises, might give properties that are unexpected. So
there is one that you should add, which is a category of points.
Yes, of course. Yeah. Points. And so on. So you see, we consider the demorganization. You see, this is a slightly weird invariant, and nobody could expect a priori that it could be relevant to fields of finite characteristics that are algebraic over their prime field. I mean, it's something that certainly you would have not come up with. But in fact, reality shows that. So you see, it has been one really has to take this view seriously, in the sense that even apparently weird invariants can possibly give deep and interesting results. Just as an example, let's take this invariant, which is really a logically motivated invariant, the Morgan's law on a topos. So it means that for any subobject, you are there. And the Boolean means that the lower excluded middle holds in the topos, in the internal logic of the topos, so it means that you are that. And let's look at how these invariants express when you apply them to different sizes such as this. So if you take Boolean, here what you get is almost discrete. X almost discrete. It means that every open is closed. If you look at it here, you get that C is a groupoid. Now take the other invariant, the Morgan. Here you get that X is extremely disconnected. And here you get that C satisfies the amalgamation property, which is this property here. So you see, we have just considered two simple invariants, and already you see the power of this.
What is the meaning of extremely?
It means that the closure of any open set is open.
Ah, okay.
So you see, on the two sides, you obtain very natural things. But if I had asked you before, do you think that there is a relationship between the property of a space to be extremely disconnected and the amalgamation property in the category? What would you have answered? Probably, well, no relation at all. While with the toposes, I mean, you have many situations in which you have equivalences between toposes of this kind and toposes of that kind. And so you can really use these things to build bridges which allow you to translate. For example, imagine you are interested in understanding if a space is extremely disconnected. If you discover that the corresponding topos can be represented in an alternative way, this will give you a way to an alternative outlook on your property, and depending on the cases, you will find something more or less interesting. It's always a surprise. One has to really work with a sort of open spirit, in the sense that you cannot control. You cannot control a priori what you will get, because it is a top-down way of doing things. Yes?
What is almost discrete?
Well, it means that every open is closed. In the you see the link with the Boolean-ness, because you see you need that every sub-object is complemented, so...
Yeah. There are many examples, important ones, mm-hmm. where... there was theory T mm-hmm. such that for every topos E,
yes.
the models of T in E are again toposes. Can they be characterized?
This I don't know. I have never considered this question.
Because then you could repeat the mm-hmm. operation and take models of T prime into the topos or models of EE and have a tensor product.
Yeah, I mean, I know that in the context of...
Kind of internal of good.
Yeah. Anyway, so we shall also give an illustration in the case of two-valuedness. This is also interesting because Matteo has asked me a question about completeness. Now, here is a simple application of this using the this invariant, two-valuedness. Now, two-valuedness, if you look at it from the point of view of the syntactic site...
What does it mean?
It means that there are just two sub-objects of one in the topos, and they are distinct from each other. So, so one is the terminal object, and so you have just these two, and they are distinct from each other. This is two-valuedness. So if you look at what it means in terms of the classifying topos of the theory, then it means that T is, say, geometrically complete. In the sense that every geometric sentence over the language of the theory is either probably true or probably false, but not both. So there is a non-triviality anywhere here. Now, if you imagine that you represent this in another way, so you consider a category C, which satisfies the amalgamation property, and you put on the opposite of it the atomic topology, which is the Grothendieck topology in which the covering six are exactly the non-empty ones. Then you get a topos, and if you look at what the two-valuedness means for this, it means precisely joint embedding property on C. It is on C.
No, she is on C.
It is on C. So you see again that here we have a property of completeness, which is in general a very hard property to establish in logic, which becomes equivalent to joint embedding property on a category, which is something much, much simpler in general. I mean, at least in terms of the statement, because it tells you that any two objects can be mapped to a third one. So you see it is much more tractable in many cases than completeness. But it is equivalent to it if you have an equivalence like that. And there are indeed situations in which you have an equivalence like that. For instance, in the context of the process construction in model theory, you have basically a situation exactly like that, in which you start from a theory of Lipschitz type, T, of then what do you do? Well, you start with it's classifying topos, and then you localize it, supposing that here you have the atomic topology. Here you have the amalgamation property. So the fact that you have the amalgamation property allows you, this is an hypothesis that you suppose, it allows you to take sheaves on the opposite of this with respect to the atomic topology. Since this is a subtopos of that, it corresponds on this side to a subtopos of that. But subtoposes of the classifying topos of a theory are classifying toposes of the quotients of the theory. So this means that I have a quotient that I still don't know, T prime, such that I can make this commute. Now, let's work on that.
What is atomic topology?
This is an atomic topos.
What is it?
An atomic topos means that that the subobject lattices in the topos are complete atomic Boolean algebras. So it means that you can cover every object as a disjoint coproduct of atoms, if you want.
And what is the atomic topos? J at?
It is the atomic topology. So it means that the sieves which cover are exactly the non-empty ones. So you have that, and then you can start playing with invariants and bridges. So you immediately observe. So here, let's write the remaining part. So here we have T prime, let's say. So you discover that the fact that the geometric property of amalgamation on this category implies that this topos is atomic. So this is one arch of our bridge. So we know that that amalgamation property here implies atomicity here. Now, we move here, since it is an invariant, and we descend there. We discover that T prime is atomic, as a theory. So it means that every formula in the language of T prime can be decomposed as a disjunction of formulas which behave as atoms with respect to probability, in the sense that you don't have, these are formulas that in a given context, such that for any other formula which I can, for any other formula in the same context, when I consider this conjunction, I know that this is between phi and false, and we say that the formula is, say, atomic, the terminology is complete, if either this is isomorphic to that or it is isomorphic to that. So you don't have anything intermediate between. So as you can see again, you have started with something geometric here, and you end up with atomicity here, which apparently was completely unrelated. So you see how many surprises one gets. And then if, as I have already mentioned, if I take a joint embedding property here, then here I get the two valuedness, and then I descend there, and I get the completeness of the field.
But what ensures that the category is non-empty?
No, you have to suppose it. Sorry, I didn't say, but you have to suppose that this category here to be non-empty, otherwise it could trivialize. But in fact, it suffices to suppose that this is non-empty to have a non-degenerate topos. It suffices. So, of course, if it is empty, it's not interesting. Okay, so...
Olivia, sorry.
Yes.
If I understand correctly, you also need the because if C as a final object, the joint embedding property is trivial, right?
Yes, but here I am stating things in full generality, so I'm not supposing any property of initial or terminal object, no. But it's true that, of course, if you have an initial object, then joint embedding follows from amalgamation. But I'm not supposing it. Okay, so you see here, from these two geometric properties, we have arrived to two completely unexpected syntactic properties, but it is not finished yet, because we have not talked about the points of these toposes. So this is our third invariant. You see, the scheme is always the same. I'm just changing the invariant. So here I put the notional point of... And here, of course, since this is by definition the classifying topos for T prime, I find the T prime models in set. Here, I find the so-called homogeneous T models. So, what is an homogeneous model? Well, it is a model M such that when you have finitely presentable models A and B with an arrow like that, and an arrow like that, you can complete this to a commutative triangle. So you see, what we can conclude from all of that is that starting from a theory of pre-shift type such that the category of its finite presentable models is non-empty and satisfies the amalgamation property, then the theory T prime, which axiomatizes the homogeneous models, is atomic and complete if and only if this category satisfies the joint embedding property. This represents a broad generalization of a classical theorem due to Frisset in model theory. So I decided to present it just to illustrate the fact that you see how this works. Apparently, one would not expect this very abstract invariance to yield completely concrete properties when you unravel them in terms of size, but this is what you get. Just an example. Then, of course, you can go on and you can wonder if you still want to represent this in an alternative way. For instance, you might wonder, when is it the case that I can represent my topos as this precise topos, when can I represent it as a Galois topos? I mean, Galois-type topos. I mean, a topos of continuous actions of a certain topological group of automorphisms of a certain structure that, of course, I want to be a model of my theory T and possibly of the quotient T prime as well. So I can wonder when it is the case that I can that I have equivalences of this kind. Because you see, this is a sort of general framework for analyzing Galois theories. In the case of Galois, here as a take as a theory of pre-shift type, you can take you start with a Galois extension and you take all the intermediate extensions, which are filtered colimits of finite extensions. So this will be just the finite extensions, and this will be the Galois group. So as you can see, if you have a classical Galois context, this gives rise to a representation of this kind. If you want to build Galois theories in a more general setting, you can ask yourself the question, when is it the case that I can represent toposes like this, in this way? Now, of course, you would not be satisfied just with an equivalence at the level of toposes. You would like this to restrict to an equivalence at the level of sites, in some sense, because you want something more concrete. Yes, please.
Oh, Olivia, just as a preliminary remark, of course it is obvious for you, but you should say that for any topological group...
You have a topos.
Yes.
So for any topological group, you can...
The discrete set observed with a continuous action, the group is a topos, and it is atomic with two values.
Yes, always. For any topological group. You take all the actions where here you consider this as a discrete set, not necessarily finite, as Grothendieck was doing with his Galois category. And you require this to be continuous by endowing this with a discrete topology.
So I presume you have very few points for this topology. Two isomorphism, probably.
Well, yes, exactly, because this will be things like algebraic closure, so okay. You see.
Okay. So for instance,
it's pretty rigid, So you wonder whether you have equivalences of this kind. So you would like, of course, these equivalences to be induced as in classical Galois theory. So basically, here, what do you have? By the unit embedding. You go there, and you would like actually this to take value in the non-empty transitive actions of the same group. Here I have not said that normally there is a standard topology to put on the automorphism group of a certain model. It is the so-called pointwise convergence topology. So you wonder also when it is the case that this restricts to a functor like that, and of course one would like this functor to be an equivalence, in order, because this is the case in classical Galois theory. You really have an equivalence that leads to an equivalence of toposes, but you have an equivalence already at the level of these sites. Now it turns out that the fact of embedding everything in a topos allows you to discover conditions, necessary and sufficient conditions for the existence of these Galois-type theories.
Why the Grothendieck topology is the atomic topology?
Well, it is forced by the fact that when you consider such a topos, this is always a two-valued atomic topos. So I have said that an atomic topos, you can always decompose every object as a disjoint union of atoms, which are the atoms in this situation where they are exactly the non-empty transitive actions. So you see, you decompose a transitive action just as a union of all the orbits. Okay, so you see, you understand that. So this always you can represent by taking sheaves on just the transitive action with respect to the atomic topology, because this is the topology that you get when you induce the canonical topology that you have here on this full subcategory. So it is determined by that, in the sense that when you induce, given the fact that this is an atom, you just get the atomic topology. So you see, it looks very similar to what you get in the other framework, and so it is natural to wonder when you have that. Now, you realize, again, the toposes help you a lot to solve this kind of problems, because, you see, starting from... So you would like this to be a functor that sends... You would like this to be the functor that sends C, a finitely presentable model, to OM of C to M, endowed with the action of the automorphisms of M. This is the what you would like, right? Now, you realize that basically every object here is sent to an atom here, but then it is sent because of the fact that this topology is atomic. So automatically I have an atom here, then I go here, and so it means that I have an atom here, but an atom here means a transitive non-entity action. So necessarily, this will take place in the transitive non-entity actions by purely abstract considerations. The problem is, first, when does such an equivalence exist, and if at the level of toposes, and then if such an equivalence exists, when it is the case that such a restriction is a full and faithful functor or even an equivalence. So how to answer this question? Well, first of all, we care about the equivalence at the level of toposes. So you realize that essentially basic conditions that it is natural to put on M. So M is universal, and M is ultra-homogeneous. Because I have observed that I want my functor to take values in the transitive non-empty actions of that. But I want this functor to be given by taking OM from C to M. So I want this OM to be non-empty. This is universality. So I want that for each M, for each C, I have an arrow from C to M. I want that. And I also want, so this corresponds to saying that the corresponding action is non-empty. So this is non-empty. And then I have the condition of transitivity. So transitivity, what does it mean? That if I have two different ways to send C into M, I have a way to send one to the other through an automorphism. And this corresponds to transitivity. So I know that these are necessary conditions, necessary. But a theorem that can be proved by using logical techniques, and I have not been able to find a proof which is concrete, only in particular cases, but in full generality, I only have a logical proof for that. These conditions are sufficient as well. So basically, if you have that M is universal and ultra-homogeneous, you have the equivalence of the velocity. Now, the only thing that remains to be seen is if this functor here, which I call F, when is F full and faithful, or even an equivalence. Because, I mean, already full and faithful would be quite good, because it means that at least you can embed your category as a subcategory of this category of transitive non-empty actions. But of course, equivalence would be even better, because basically it would mean that every open subgroup of this automorphism group come from something, from some C, from some object C in your category. And so, I mean, in the case of a classical Galois theory, you really have an equivalence, but you might be content already with something like that, because If you are in a situation like that, you can wonder how, what you have to do to complete your category in order to get something that is equivalent to the category on the on that side. And in fact, I have described a procedure to complete a category which satisfies the first condition to a full Galois theory. This is a procedure that consists in a sort of addition of imaginaries. Basically, if you have the first condition but not the second, it means that some quotients by natural equivalence relations that you can take in the first context, they are not realized by something in the by the category itself. And so in order for them to be realized, you have to enlarge the category. But it is completely explicit. You can give a way to complete it. It's a very calculatory activity. I mean, I should stress that the toposes, when you look at them from the point of view of size, they become very computational devices, in the sense that you can really compute very, very well, not just with size, but even with other ways, other objects that you can use to represent toposes, such as groupoids or quantiles, etc. Size are the main sort of way to represent them. And I can tell you that for many of those invariants that I mentioned, they behave extremely well in terms of size, in the sense that you can find site characterizations that give you the arches of your bridges in many, many situations. In some cases, you can even find them by purely mechanical calculations. For instance, the results about Boolean on the or the Morgan, all the logical conditions that you can put on the internal sub-object classifier of the topos, this you can do in a completely mechanical way. This means that, you see, it is extremely well behaved. But let's come back to this. So how to characterize when F is full and faithful? Well, you realize that full and faithfulness of F corresponds precisely, you can look at F as taking values here in the topos, and it corresponds precisely to saying that this Grothendieck topology is subcanonical. And this, in turn, you can express by saying that all the arrows here are strict monomorphisms, which is a completely concrete condition. So you have an answer to the first question, and so thanks to this, for instance, you can discover many new Galois-type theories in different areas of mathematics. For instance, we have a Galois theory for finite groups, in that sense, for Boolean algebras, for graphs, etc. These are all situations in which the first condition is satisfied. For the second condition, for instance, all the contexts that Grothendieck treated in his theory of Galois categories provide actually an equivalence as well. But you might not have an equivalence in general, due to the fact that there might be atoms of this topos which are not representable, in the sense that, you know that all the objects here give rise to atoms here. But in principle, there could be atoms here that do not come from there. So, you can formulate a completely explicit condition on this category for it to be atomically closed, in the sense that every atom that you consider here comes from something there. So again, it is completely explicit. I do not write it down. If you are interested, all of this is described in this paper that is called Topological Galois Theory. And again, what I want to stress here is that really it is a topospheretic invariance that guide you in this sort of otherwise very concrete investigation. Because after all, you are really looking for concrete correspondences between open subgroups on one end and your finitely presented objects on the other. So it is a completely concrete problem, but in some sense, it is really through toposes that you get the right notions, that you get the right conditions, because all I have said here is not sufficient, it is also necessary. So you see, in some sense, it is the optimal framework that you can use to address this kind problem, if you want. And so, as you can see, it is always a game of invariance and how to express this invariance on one side or the other. Okay, now,
Olivia,
yes.
Maybe you could mention that this general setup applies to very concrete classical situations.
Yes, this I have said.
Oh, okay, excuse me.
Yeah. You were. In fact, I was a bit upset.
Did you mention the example of the Chanuel topos?
No, the Chanuel topos not, but this is really the simplest possible one. That, so if you take as a theory of pre-shift type, the theory of just, it is called the theory of decidable objects, in which you have just one sort, and you have this difference predicate with the axioms that I brought down yesterday at the request of Goyal. This will be the basic theory of pre-shift type I, and basically what you have is that, so of course you have a category I, category of finite sets and injections.
So this is a category of
finitely presentable models of this theory. So this is the topos, and you can represent it as continuous actions of an automorphism group of whatever infinite set you might want. So here I have put n, but I can replace n with any s. And this is very interesting because you see...
infinite s.
At infinite, yes. You need
the
set to
be... Whatever cardinality? Or?
Yes, yes. And that's very interesting, you see, because imagine that you want to put into... So in particular, you have that continuous actions of a certain S is the same thing as continuous actions of the automorphism
sure.
group of S.
I suppose that this topos has only one point,
No, it has every infinite set as a point.
And this I don't understand, because it's continuous action of a group.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So let's take the group to be finite, for instance.
Yes.
So there is
no, but it's not finite necessarily.
No,
because
but
here
but
I don't
here
have a finite group.
Automorphism
it is automorphism group of an infinite set.
No, I understand, but what I don't understand is that when we take a... So this is what... This is the... It's not the same thing as taking the group itself, and taking the dual of it as a small category with a single object, so it's not the same thing.
No. No, these are rigid things
okay.
in which you only have... No.
Okay.
No, this is a continuous.
Okay.
The topology plays
a role.
Yeah, yeah,
if there was no topology, there would be only one point.
So, now, you see here, it is interesting because you cannot put S and S prime in relation to each other directly. You have no way. But they are unified through the topos. So you see, even in a very simple situation like this, I mean, even at the level of automorphism groups, you cannot compare very often. But still, when you pass to the topos, they are unified. So you see, all of this illustrates the fact that if you really want to perform unification, toposes are, in some sense, the best way to go.
So
because
what are choices of S now? I don't.
What are the conditions on S?
No, it is infinite. You take S infinite.
Oh. And you're saying for any infinite S?
Yeah,
so
yeah,
it is,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Any infinite S. So you see, in fact, I wanted to apply this framework about this both Galois theory and generalized Vassé to the study of the independence of L in L-adic cohomology. Because in I have written a paper about that recently, which is called Motivic Toposes, and I suggest, basically, that this L-adic cohomologies should be homogeneous for a certain appropriate choice of the theory of pre-shift type. And this, of course, is a long-term project, and I don't expect to come up with an answer to that. I don't know whether they are actually homogeneous or not. But if they were, in some sense, it would... explain the fact that you see there we cannot really compare these different homologies in a direct way because they are defined over different coefficient fields. So it is not natural to don't have a natural dictionary for comparing them. But this could provide a dictionary. if it works. So I'm not claiming it will work, but I just mentioned that there are several indications that show that it is not a completely unreasonable point of view on the subject, especially because the exactness condition for cohomology theories follows as a particular case of homogeneity. So in some sense, it is an indication of the fact that at least the approach is relevant. I mean, it is not completely...
Yeah. And Olivia, maybe you could also add the remark that not depending on the fact that this approach works or not,
yes.
Anyway, this general setup of classifying toposes which are atomic and true valued,
yes.
Encompass in the same framework the Galois approach and the Tanaka approach, which means it does not distinguish anymore between what is linear and what is non-linear.
Yes, if you want, yeah. This is also another aspect that, okay, anyway, how much time do I have? Perfect, okay. So I would like to conclude with more general considerations and a few other examples. These are the main ones, but... of this bridge technique, because I have pointed out that the two basic ingredients of bridges are bags of bridges, which are given by Morita-equivalences. And arches, which are given by site characterization. So let's say a few words more about each of these topics. We have already talked a lot about the site characterization, about the fact that topospheretic invariants express often in very natural ways in terms of sites. But we haven't really said too much about the first topic, Morita equivalences. So, because apparently the notion of Morita equivalence is a very restricted one, I mean, at first sight, because you have that the two theories are Morita equivalent when they have equivalent categories of models in every topos, naturally in the topos. So, this by definition of classifying topos, of course. So you have that for all E, naturally in E. So apparently, if you look at this definition, it might seem very rare, very rarely occurring in mathematics, because, I mean, after all, you require that the categories of models should be equivalent, not just in sets. In particular, you also require them to be equivalent in sets, but you require them in some sense to be equivalent from the point of view of whatever topos you might choose. And since we have infinitely many toposes, and I mean, they resemble to one another for many aspects, but there are also differences between them. So a priori, it is not clear whether there are many Morita equivalences around or not. So I would like to make just a few general considerations about this, especially because Ancon has asked about the relationship between, equivalence of categories of models in sets and this. Now, what we can say is that, suppose that sometimes it happens in practice that first you discover an equivalence like that. And then you wonder, is it a Morita equivalence? Because, of course, imagine if you can lift to a Morita equivalence, then you can apply the bridges and... And this, as we have seen, allows you to translate a lot of things in surprising ways. So, do you have a high likelihood that your equivalence lifts or not? Well, it depends. It depends on how you have built this equivalence. Of course, it is not in general true that you can lift, because, for instance, there are geometric theories that have no points, that have no set-based models. So, you see, from the point of view of sets, they could be perfectly equivalent to the contradictory theory, but without being contradictory themselves. So, for sure, it is not always true, but when you have established this equivalence, you have only used constructive principles, because you need this in order to be able to generalize the definition of the two functors forming the equivalence. You want to lift it to the case of an arbitrary topos. So you want not to have exploited anything inherently set theoretic when you have done this. So if you, so for instance, you cannot use the law of excluded middle, you cannot use the axiom of choice. So you see, you have to, if you have been careful to avoid this, and if the functors that you have used to define the equivalence are in some sense geometric, in the sense that you have only used geometric constructions such as finite limits and arbitrary collimits in defining this, then you can reasonably expect this to lift. So this is a sort of heuristic principle, of course, but I mean, we have applied it with Anna Carla Russo, that will give a talk on this in the contributed session on Wednesday. We have applied this to two known equivalences in the context of NV algebras, and we were able to, by making a careful analysis of how these functors were defined, we were able to lift them to Morita-equivalences. And thanks to this, we were able to discover new results that the specialists of the area couldn't attain with their methods. For instance, we had an equivalence, which was Mundici's equivalence, an interesting one, between on one end the category of Boolean of NV algebras, on the other end the category of of lattice order abelian groups with strong unit, which is an infinitary theory. So you see, you have on one end a finite algebraic theory, on the other end an infinitary theory, but Mundici proved that they are equivalent in sense, but the two theories are not bi-interpretable, in the sense that you can prove that the syntactic categories of the two are not equivalent. We proved that also in the paper. And so it was a natural question to ask, okay, we don't have a bi-interpretability, so because of that it could be all the more interesting to find the Morita equivalence, because, for instance, the duality theorem tells you that if you have Morita equivalence, even though you don't have bi-interpretability, you have a bijective correspondence between the quotients of the two theories. And this is by no means trivial, because imagine, if you have a dictionary, of course you know how to do, because you take each formula on one end and you send it on the other end, and so it is completely trivial. But imagine if you don't have. Still, we managed to show that you have a bijective correspondence, and we were able also to describe how this correspondence works, but it doesn't work in a linear way, of course. And this is the kind of things that specialists in that area couldn't see, because one really needed the topos theoretic viewpoint. So anyway, so this was the first thing I wanted to say, the link between equivalence in sets and equivalence in an arbitrary topos. So I have already talked about bi-interpretability. I should also mention that all the classical notions of Morita equivalence that have been considered for many structures, such as I have already mentioned associative rings before, but also topological groups, inverse semigroups, small categories. So all the classical notions of Morita equivalence fit into this, in the sense that you can attach to those structure toposes, and then the Morita equivalences become equivalent to equivalences of this classifying toposes. So in some sense, this general notion of Morita equivalence encompasses most of the notion of Morita equivalences that have been proposed in the literature. Now, there is something that I would like also to say. It's about duality theory. You might wonder what is the link between Morita equivalences and dualities. Because you see, here we have talked about covariant equivalences. But what about dualities? I mean, dualities, I mean equivalences between a concrete category and the opposite of another concrete category. Of course, this is will not be a Morita equivalence in that sense, but there is a nice link between the two, in the sense that dualities arise from factorializations of Morita equivalences. What do I mean by this? This is a sort of a slogan, if you want. So it means that when you have a duality, you can consider each pair of objects related by the duality. And then what happens very frequently is that this pair of objects is related, the two objects of the pair are related to each other through a topos that you can construct from each of them separately. And so you have, in some sense, a bridge for each pair. And then by functorializing this bridge, you get your duality. Just an example will be clearer than many words. So take stone duality, very simple duality. For instance, take for a Boolean algebra. So you have a Boolean algebra and the corresponding stone space. Well,
complete or not?
Sorry?
Complete Boolean algebra?
No, not necessarily.
You take local.
No, later I will also discuss the case of complete atomic Boolean algebras. For those, you have another duality, you have Lindenbaum, Tarski duality. This is for complete atomic Boolean algebras. I will discuss later. So here, stone duality. So of course, it is a duality between the category of Boolean algebras and the category of stone spaces. And here, basically, you see that for each Boolean algebra, you have a topos that you obtain by equipping this algebra, regarded as a pre-ordered category, with the coherent topology, which is, this is a distributive lattice, so it is a coherent category. It is a coherent poset category, so you can certainly put the coherent topology on it, and what you get is that it's precisely equivalent to the topos of sheaves on the space. So you see, the way you get the duality out of that is as follows. So you imagine you want to make B vary. So here you have B, and here you have that. So if you take a morphism of Boolean algebra here, what you get there is a geometric morphism going here. Then you transfer the geometric morphism here. And since these spaces are Hausdorff, then you can exit the bridge there. And so you get, so it was going there, and so it's going here. So you see that
J coherent?
Coherent, it means that finite joints. So the covering sieves are those which contain finite joints. So, I mean, things like that. You have B, B1, Bn, like that. So you require this. So, and for Lindenbaum-Tarski duality, it's also cute in the sense that if you have such a an atomic Boolean algebra, complete atomic Boolean algebra A, then you know that you can reconstruct it from the set of its atoms just by taking the power set. So it's something very trivial, at least at the level of objects. It is slightly more interesting at the level of arrows, the kind of understanding that toposes provide on that, because, you see, in the other direction it works like that. So, you see, this is the duality. And topos theoretically, it is like that. So, you have on one end the topos of sheaves on A with respect to the canonical topology. Here you take all joints, not just finite ones. This is equivalent to atoms. And now, you see, when you take the arrows in between these complete Boolean algebras, you don't just, in this duality, you don't just take the frame arrows, You take all the complete arrows, the ones that preserve also infima, arbitrary infima. So conceptually, it is not completely clear why you take those. Now, the topos theoretic perspective explains you this as well. Because you see, when you imagine you have just a frame morphism here, then for sure you have a geometric morphism here. But then you wonder, when it is the case that this morphism comes from a function, you see, between this. Not all geometric morphisms here come from geometric morphisms induced by this. They are exactly the essential geometric morphisms. Essential means that the inverse image has a left adjoint, and having a left adjoint in the context of means exactly. So you understand exactly why you need this condition. Anyway, this was just to illustrate that.
Can you do something similar in the same vein for local?
Well, yes, of course. I mean, my paper about this, which is called the topos theoretic approach to stone type duality, is all with locals, all. So
even it works with local.
Yeah, because it is way. More. When you work with toposes are really, as Yael said, they are strict generalizations of locals rather than topological.
I meant that for the duality between frames and locals. I mean, does it fall into this pattern?
Yes, if you want, but it is a sort of quite a trivial adjunction. So I mean, these are a bit more contentful dualities than that one. Anyway, this is just to explain this slogan. Now, of course, these are very elementary examples, but I hope that at least illustrate the point. How much do I have? Five, okay. So,
minus five.
Yeah.
Eight, if you want.
Sorry?
If you want, you can have 8 minutes.
Oh, excellent. We will see what the topos is decide. Okay, so finally, I would like to say that the notion of Morita equivalence actually formalizes in many situations the feeling of looking at a certain object in different ways. So when you feel that you can look at something, when I say look at something, I might mean you can construct something or you can represent something in a certain way or in another, it is very likely that you are in presence of a Morita equivalence. This I tell you because even in mathematical theory alone generate infinite many Morita equivalents. It might seem incredible, but it's like that. Because you see, a mathematical theory is not like a dead object. I mean, it is something that, starting from the axioms, it starts developing. So whatever new result that you find in the theory allows you to split the theory into the past and the future, in some sense. I mean, what you already know to be true in the theory and what is potentially true in the sense of provable. So whatever split that you want to make about your theory will give rise to a different representation of its classifying topos by the duality theorem about the subtoposes. Because you see, if you look at a certain theory T as a quotient of a certain theory S, then you will get a representation of its classifying topos as a subtopos of this. So it will be it will be the syntactic category of this with a certain topology. So you see, it will depend on S. So if I change S, I will get many different, and it is not innocent as it might seem. For instance, because as I said, classifying topologies are very sensitive to logic. So even if you make a small change at the level of logic, you can have huge differences in the difficulty or easiness of calculations that you might want to perform. For instance, I mentioned the paper that I wrote with Peter Johnson about the Morgan's law applied to the theory of fields. First, we tried to compute the invariant that we wanted to compute by using the representation of the theory of fields as a quotient of the theory of rings, just commutative rings. And we didn't manage to calculate. Then we changed the theory. We chose the theory of von Neumann regular rings, which is just a little variation. Because, I mean, after all, of course. I mean, the only thing you have to observe is that every field is a von Neumann regular ring, which is completely trivial.
Well, yeah, what is a von Neumann?
Well, it means that you have a pseudo inverse.
Yeah, you have a pseudo inverse.
So, I mean, instead of having just the inverse, you require, you see, to have something like that. You see, something like that. So, you see, it is completely trivial, but for us, the calculations became much easier because we got the topology was subcanonical in that case, but not in the other case, and so we managed to calculate much better. So you see, even a small difference can make a huge difference at the level of calculation.
Did you try the skew fields?
No, I didn't try. Anyway, just to illustrate, so we have talked about the big Zariski spectrum of a ring. Let's talk about the small, the petit topos, of a ring. So we have just sheaves on the Zariski spectrum of A. And here, it's a very simple object. But even if it is simple, you can come up with different points of view on it. And each of these points of view translates into a different way of representing this topos. For instance, this is the classifying topos of a certain theory, which axiomatizes the prime filters over of the ring. The prime filters are exactly the complements of prime ideas. So you have, you see, a logical theory that gives, so this you can see as a topological representation, a representation of, and this is logical, if you want. And then you can also represent this as sheaves on a distributive lattice with respect to the coherent topology on it, because it turns out that this theory is actually coherent. And so by using the coherent way of building classifying, I mean, the way of building classifying topologies for coherent theories, here by taking the coherent syntactic category of this theory, you get an alternative representation. This is a distributive lattice, you see? So if you want to work with distributive lattices instead of topological spaces, you can, yeah.
You mean the theory of the prime filters on the ring is fixed and you axiomatize
Yes.
How do you axiomatize it as a first
order? These are propositional theories. Propositional theory is a theory over a signature which has no sorts. And propositional, so you only have zero RE relation symbols, nothing else. And propositional theories correspond exactly to localic topos, in the sense that a localic topos is classified by, is always classified by a propositional theory, and conversely, any propositional theory has a localic classifier.
How can you axiomatize it as a first order theory?
It is first order, but
you have to quantify on these subsets.
No, because you take one symbol for each element.
Ah, okay.
So, in this way, you are done. So, but then it's not finished, because you also have the possibility of cutting this site down to a mid-semi lattice, because it turns out that actually you don't need this whole thing. It suffices to work with a mid-semi lattice, which is given by you first. Look at A as a monoid, yes, and just by taking the multiplication, and then you quotient by the smallest equivalence relation that identifies A with A square, and then you get this monoid. And notice that here you have only talked about multiplication. The Grothendieck topology that you will put will talk about addition. And so the unification of these two things will give the same result. And of course, it doesn't finish here, so you can always consider the frame of radical ideas of A, and then you have the canonical topology of that. So you see, this was just to illustrate that every different point of view you have translates in something like that. This is useful because, for instance, imagine that instead of considering just spectra made by prime ideas, you want to consider spectra made by maximal ideas, for instance. In functional analysis, this is what you want. And so,
because they are the same.
Well, not, but there are situations in which, I mean, so in these situations, what do you do? Well, you observe that here you have a subtopos, if you take the induced topology, And then you can localize everything else. In particular, and this can be surprising because you see, you are sure that you can axiomatize the complements of the prime ideals in first order logic, but it is not a priori clear that the notion of maximal ideal allows you to do that as well. And so you have a surprise. You know that by the duality theorem for subtoposes, you know that there exists a theory. There exists a theory. And you don't know what it is, but you know that there exists a geometric theory over the same language.
Oh, yeah. How do you handle the morphisms for this max of A?
The morphisms?
Oh, no, A is fixed.
Yes. Okay, so I'm fixing A. Okay. So you see, here I know that there exists a theory, a geometric theory over the same signature as the one that I had used for describing the prime filters, that works for the maximal things. This can be surprising because a priori you don't expect there to be a first order thing, but you know, for instance, that if this is a sober, and I mean normally this is Hausdorff, so it is necessarily sober, you know that the set-based models of this will be exactly they will be in correspondence, let's say, with the maximal ideals of A, and it is actually possible to calculate this theorem. So I have, just as an exercise, I have calculated it, because you see the duality theorem is not just something abstract in the sky, it's something that allows you really to calculate. And so it is actually possible to calculate this, and so you get a theory that actually axiomatizes the complements of maximal ideals, and, well, I don't know if it's useful for something, but anyway, it is just to say that you have a guide to work. You see, you can. Everything is very continuous. I can make a change, and this change has consequences everywhere. You see, everything is connected. So, I mean, to conclude, I would just like to say that, well, I hope to have suggested to you that Grothendieck toposes can indeed act very effectively as unifying spaces across different situations, and even inside a given mathematical field, not necessarily for connecting things belonging to different mathematical fields, but just working, you see, as in this situation, with a specific structure, it can be very useful. So it is a very technical, powerful tool. And of course, as you can see in all this story, sites are fundamental. So, I mean, by working with sites, I have attracted a lot of hostility from the people that I was mentioning earlier in the talk. It is very unfortunate because, I mean, sites, as you can see, are really central. So I hope that these controversies will be overcome, and that beautiful mathematics will be produced. Okay, thank you.